Belinda Audio presents this unabridged recording of The Biographer, written by Virginia Duigan and read by Julie Nihill. The dedication reads, "To the two John Duigans, my brother and my uncle, and to my sister and brother-in-law, Helen and Jan Zenbergs." Chapter 1. Wednesday, 5th of July. Today I met an extraordinary man. Oddly enough, or perhaps not, I knew straight away he was someone out of the ordinary. Well, you'd have to be blind, deaf, and monumentally dumb not to notice that Mr. S is on the right side of unique. It was a medium-sized notebook, about the width of a woman's clutch bag, with a shiny red cover that hadn't been opened for 25 years. The pages were bone dry, but otherwise unaffected. The words crowded together and sloping to the right, fast and energetic. Greer looked at the flamboyant script, the extravagant surge of the writing. "Myself when young," she thought. "Someone I hardly recognise." Last month had brought a letter from Anthony. The envelope, with its address printed in indelible black marker, stood out from the rest of the post, which was mainly bills and Artworld bumf. Normally Anthony preferred email, and she thought it was significant that this time he had chosen to write. A handwritten letter was challenging, tangible. It lay there in front of you. You could pick it up as often as you liked and reread it, or tear it up and chuck it away. Or put a match to it, perhaps. Even the act of opening the envelope, which Greer had finally slit with a slender-bladed letter opener, set up an expectation. The letter lay on her desk all afternoon until she brought herself to open it. After reading it, she hadn't crumpled it up, tossed it in the bin or burnt it, but put it down, her heart thumping. Anthony had written, "I wonder if you could look out any material you might have from the early days. Press cuttings, of course, and reviews. But also photographs, letters, appointment books, and general detritus. Especially mad ephemera, like doodles on the side of laundry lists. Dare one hope for a diary or three? But absolutely anything you may have salvaged from the Australian period would be of use." The Australian period. Reading the three words made her mouth dry. They lay there on the page in strong, masculine handwriting. Three words, clear and unambiguous. Might they have been innocently put down? She stared at the writing as a graphologist might, as if it could be deciphered, searching for clues, but it told her nothing. After looking at three words for a while, she thought any three words, they become meaningless, and the implications that may or may not swirl around them cease to exist. They are like words in an unfamiliar language, mere arrangements of letters that have lost their power, the power they may have had to make your heart stand still. In any case, a graphologist would be looking for revelations of character and not of knowledge. The letter still lay face up on her desk. What kind of person wrote in this way? As if people's lives were like segments of an orange to be pulled apart. Or worse, labelled, dissected and denounced. Greer had mentioned the letter to Rollo. She knew it was unfair to expect Rollo to take those three words at anything other than face value. And he didn't. They sounded perfectly innocuous to him. "It's a necessity of the biographical process, darling," he'd said. "What did you expect? This is what happens from now on. Your lives will be annotated, analysed, and arranged in alphabetical order. Reduced to lists in a filing cabinet. They're not your lives anymore, you see. You're in the process of being reinvented for public consumption. You belong to posterity now and trivial pursuit. It's tedious, but exciting. Don't look so tragic. Wallow in all the fuss. Lie back and enjoy it."
"But you don't understand, Rollo," she thought.
You haven't a clue. If you had, you wouldn't joke about it. Even Guy, you see. Even Guy might hesitate. Most of Antony's communications had been with Mischa, but he had addressed this particular letter to her. Allowing for my admittedly patchy knowledge of Misha's habits, I have a suspicion he hasn't bothered to record a great deal. You are probably the archivist of the partnership. The archivist. Another word that branded him, in her eyes, as an outsider. An enemy alien. After 4 days, she had steeled herself to write back. If by archivist you mean the one who throws things into boxes, then yes, I suppose I qualify. But it's a very grand title for what has been woefully piecemeal and amateurish. Mischa hates keeping anything, and I've been neither systematic nor thorough. There are a few boxes of jumbled cuttings, exhibition invitations, reviews, that sort of thing. Completely unsorted. Your job will be cut out to get them into any useful order, I'm afraid. Before posting the letter, she tore it up and emailed her reply instead. During the 4 intervening days before Greer answered the letter, the unknown Antony had followed her around. He was there in the bedroom in the morning, a critical voyeur watching her dress. Instead of reaching for clothes unthinkingly, she found herself pausing to make selections and looking at herself in the mirror. He was a third faceless presence at dinner. Mischa was oblivious to him, shoveling food with his usual gusto. Greer felt unusually constrained to make conversation. Companionable silence might too easily be misinterpreted, might be put down to imagined tensions and resentments. Might, in the mind of a silent arbiter, be put down to something else altogether. When she picked up an English glossy magazine, she felt him looking over her shoulder. He was inquisitive about what she was reading, curious about every aspect of her. She discarded the magazine and from a pile of books picked up one of J.B. Priestley's more obscure novels, which Rollo had lent her last week. Be flattered by the prospect of his scrutiny, Rollo had advised. Wallow in it. But she did not find it flattering. One night she even dreamt of Antony, but when she tried to recall his appearance, she could remember nothing. There had been an uneasy feeling pervading the dream, though, an aura that still lingered, an aura of threat. She tried to redefine him as benevolent, a benign, authorial presence who was only concerned to put on record the life of a successful painter and give Mischa his due, and in so doing, to impose a semblance of order on his and later on their joint ragtag past. Wasn't that the main purpose of biography? An attempt to define a life by tracing its chronological evolution? If you were to put a life, any life, under the microscope, you might conceivably work out a formula to separate the random elements from the deliberate choices. There were conundrums here that Greer had thought about a great deal lately. Still, when considered in this way, a biography sounded fairly harmless, beneficial even, with the potential to enlarge the range of human understanding. Until the relative calm of the past decade, Mischa's life, and by assumption her own, had been so nomadic and almost willfully undocumented that the most assiduous biographer would have his work cut out trying to make any sense of it. There wouldn't be much time left for anything on the periphery. It would be a matter of imposing an artificial order on chaos. It's Mischa's business anyway, she told herself. I am on the periphery. She tried to put herself in Antony's shoes. A biographer, she supposed, would take the raw materials, birth, character, personality, and superimpose on them the achievements of the will and the accidents of fate, attempting, in the process, to answer a recurring question that could never be answered with absolute certainty. Was this the result of that? But a life could be affected forever by an accidental meeting, a chance encounter of two people. There was no avoiding that. It was what made the world go round. Two lives could be fundamentally changed, to be specific, and not only two, to be more specific still. There were causal questions Anthony would certainly ask, to which the answers were unequivocal. How far might he wish to go? If it was legitimate for a biographer to ask, to what extent has this person dictated his or her own fate, might he not also ask, to what extent has this person dictated the fates of others? I was the only one there when he came in. I knew he was coming. Verity had told me to look out for him. She'd said, "He's noisy, big, you won't mistake him." Well, that was accurate, I suppose. But what she hadn't told me was how potent, how archetypally male he was. That's typical of Verity. She probably hadn't even noticed. She's kind of impervious to men. I think she must have been de-sexed, or else everything's atrophied from lack of use. How awful would that be? Unthinkable. Anyway, he came staggering in, carrying a huge painting, which was covered in a mouldy bit of felt, dumped it down without a word to me and rushed out again, and lurched back in with another. Then he yelled, "Are you a real person? Are you a fragment of my imagination? Is it too much to ask for help before it pelts with rain?" "You mean a figment of your imagination," I said. "But I'm impressed with your vocabulary, so I'll help." He had a very thick accent, not sexy like a Frenchman, but not unappealing. We lugged pictures in from his ancient ute he'd borrowed that looked as if it had been rotting in a paddock for centuries. He looked a bit like that himself. Inches of stubble, long hair that looked dirty, frayed T-shirt hanging out under his sweater, filthy canvas shoes tied up with string. I told him he could do with a wash. "So, you're being rude to me now, as well as lazy." I couldn't tell if he was affronted or not. It was true, he stank. I said he could use the shower in Verity's flat, but he wouldn't have it, and insisted on starting to hang the pictures. I tried to tell him V would have a fit because she always wants things hung her way, but he just ignored me and started banging in nails. Greer shivered in the pale sunlight, clasping her arms under her breast. Mischa had asked early that morning, and unusually for him, almost tentatively,
"What is this albatross on your mind?"
Mindful of Anthony's scrutiny, she plucked something out of the air. "I was thinking, does first imply second?"
"First? First of what? First love?"
"If you say the first something, anything, does it imply the existence of a second?"
"Mrs. Smith, you are a mystery to me. You are my first true love. You know that. I have no strength for a second, not at my stage of life."
She had gone on to say, but he hadn't waited to hear. "It's not just a position, is it? It's expressing a potential, the potential for a second." She would discuss it with Rollo sometime. He was always interested in everything. The more fanciful, the more pointless, the better. She thought, in actual fact, "Mischa, what you just said was not strictly true on two counts. I wasn't your first true love at all. Your first and enduring love is something quite different. And neither was I your first carnal love. But you were mine. Oh yes, you were mine." She had no doubt in her mind of that. The conjunction of ideas and memories gave her an ache in the heart, as if something lying there, which had not made its presence felt for years, was turning over. The weak April sunlight lay on the wide windowsills and rebounded off the stone. Greer lifted her hands from the red exercise book and held them in the light. The hands of a middle-aged woman, she thought. No age spots, no wrinkles, but a certain puckering of the skin when the fingers were spread. She turned them over. The palms were soft, unmarked by calluses or scars. Not the hands of a woman who did hard physical work. What kind of a woman's hands, then, were they? They looked capable enough. The long fingers pleasing in their symmetry. The square palms marked by well-defined grooves, like an etching. They might strike an observer as a confident woman's hands. Were they? On the fleshy mound below each thumb was a tangled grid of tiny crisscrossed lines. Years ago, a clairvoyant in Sydney had told her that meant passion. She had been unsurprised to hear this. It confirmed something she had recently discovered about herself. She was a passionate woman. She remembered exactly how old she was when she made this discovery. Almost 30 years of age. Somewhat advanced in years, many might think, to arrive at such a momentous realization. This part of her must have been there before, must have been there always. But until she was nearly...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.